Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you.
Every once in a while, I hear something from a Muslim or anyone in particular, and I don't even know how to respond because it's like a special kind of stupid when they say things. So sometimes they'll cite things like Revelation and say that Jesus on the cross is actually the Antichrist on the cross because they think that the Bible is going to preach a message to say that Jesus was not crucified, but the Antichrist was the one who was crucified. It's hysterically laughable. Wanted to make you leave your evil religion and turn towards the God who loves you and loves you unconditionally and loved you so much he was willing to enter into creation, humble himself, take your sins upon his flesh, have that flesh crucified so that you can be forgiven. Jesus on the cross is actually the Antichrist on the cross because they think that the Bible is going to preach a message to say that Jesus was not crucified, but the Antichrist was the one who was crucified. They think that the Bible is going to preach a message to say that Jesus was not crucified, but the Antichrist was the one who was crucified. Of the Lamb who was slaughtered. Who was slaughtered? Who does the Bible say the Lamb of God is? Jesus. So Jesus, the Lamb of God, has the authority to write people's names into the book of life.
I did not die in reality, but in appearance. My death, which they think happened to them in their error and blindness, since they nailed their man unto their death. Yes, they saw me. They punished me. It was not I. But I was rejoicing in the height over all the wealth of the Archons and of their offspring, of their error and their empty judgment. And I was laughing at their ignorance.
I'm going to pause here for a moment, talk to y'all face to face. Now, you will recall when Jesus is tempting, when Satan is tempting Jesus out in the desert, he takes him up to a high mountain and offers to give him all of the world. Okay, so think about this, written 600 years before Islam is Christianity, to where the devil, Satan, tried to give Jesus the whole world to reign over. So whose world is it to give in this particular circumstance the authority to reign over the world? Well, it is the dragon. Okay, so they worshiped the dragon because he gave authority to the beast. So the dragon, Satan, gave authority to Muhammad. Muhammad accepted this, whereas Jesus was smart enough not to listen to what Satan said. Well, Satan said the same thing, essentially, to Muhammad, and Muhammad could not resist. The dragon gave him power, his throne, and great authority. So who is the leader of the Muslims, and who did he get his authority from? Many people say Allah, but Allah sent an angel, quote-unquote angel, sounds like a demon, or sounds even like Satan himself, to choke him and make him think that he was attacked by an evil spirit.
I don't believe it. Well, look at right here, Acts chapter 16, verse 16. And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with the spirit of divination. Now, we all know that that woman is demon-possessed. Now, that woman is satanic. Which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. What? What? Why would Satan proclaim the gospel, the right gospel? Why would Satan proclaim the gospel, the right gospel?
All right, so we're going to continue on in Revelation. One of its heads appeared to be fatally wounded, but his fatal wound was healed. The whole earth was amazed and followed the beast. Let's see what Revelation says. And I saw a beast coming out of the sea. He had 10 horns and 7 heads. On his horns were 10 diadems, and on his heads were blasphemous names. I'm going to make an argument to say that Islam is the beast. How many heads does the beast have? 7. Is that a coincidence? Is that ironic? Maybe. All right, but as we know about Islamic history, Islam is basically, or was basically, a monster when it first started. It was ferocious, and it was spread through the sword. Its power grew.
According to Revelation, the Antichrist is not a secular power. This isn't about barcodes and credit cards or computers named the Beast. This is about worship. This is a religious power.
So it has to be a power that is worldwide, has to be a power that has led people contrary to Scripture, and 3, it has to be a power that has persecuted. And history tells us this is exactly what has happened. I mean, all you got to do is go back and read. Read about such things as the massacre of St. Bartholomew. Read about the Spanish Inquisition. The Inquisition of the Dutch. History will tell you this. The Church of Rome has shed more innocent blood than any other institution that has ever existed among mankind. Will be questioned by no Protestant who has a competent knowledge of history. And I mentioned this the other night when I was speaking about it. Pope John Paul II made a public apology for all they had done. The lives of people they have taken by the millions over the years.
He was also given authority over every tribe, people, language, and nation. Taking a look at this, he was permitted to wage war against the saints and to conquer them. So when Islam spread, it actually did start conquering Christianity and the Christian world, so to speak, and it was because that it was given the authority to do that. If anyone rejects the beast, they will be put to death by the sword of the beast. But if those saints stay strong, they will be rewarded with eternal life. Back to Revelation. If anyone is destined for captivity, into captivity he goes. If anyone is to be killed with the sword he will be killed. This demands the perseverance of faith of the saints.
In 1478, Spanish Inquisition. to torture. You know, the Spaniards said, you know, if you Jews want to stay here, you got to convert, become Christian, become Roman Catholic. And some of them did, but then they would secretly do their Jewish stuff because they were just doing an external conversion. And so to, if they suspected the Jew of still secretly keeping Passover, still secretly abstaining from pork, still secretly eating unleavened bread during Passover, they would torture them to get them to confess. And then if a Jew who had converted, if he got caught doing some of that Jewish stuff, which was really biblical stuff, if he said, I want, you know, okay, I'll stop doing it, I'll come back to the church, they would have to go through this. This is out of Michael Brown's book. If they wanted to come back into the church, they had to be paraded through the streets, men and women alike, bareheaded, barefooted, and naked to the waist. The procession headed by a group of monks. They held unlit candles in their hands, the Jews did, indicating they were yet in spiritual darkness. They were marched through the city till they arrived at the cathedral. A chaplain would make the sign of the cross on the foreheads of these Jews, many of whom had been prominent citizens and respected leaders of their city. Then he would recite these words, "Receive the sign of the cross which you denied and which being deluded you lost." And then there would be a sermon, and then they were to be whipped in procession on each of the following six Fridays, naked to the waist, bareheaded, barefooted, and they were to fast on each of those six Fridays, and they were disqualified for the rest of their lives from holding office.
Later in the same chapter, Jesus tells his followers to love even their enemies. He says to the crowd, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven."
Now, you might be thinking to yourself, yeah, but Daniel, the Nazis weren't real Christians. Well, I know that and you know that. But what is a Jew supposed to think? I mean, think about this. What is a Jew supposed to think? Prior to the Holocaust, you had century after century after century of bloody, butchering persecution done in the name of Jesus. And the Nazis were church-going people. Most of them, they were professing Christians, Lutherans or Catholics or whatever. They were a church-going culture. And the motto of the German Christians, and this is out of Erdmann's Handbook to the History of Christianity, the motto of the German Christians was, quote, "The swastika on our breasts, the cross in our hearts." Also from the same Christian book, it says, a German pastor named Luthuser said these words. He said, "Christ has come to us through Adolf Hitler. We know today the Savior has come." So what's a Jew supposed to think? I mean, we can say, well, those guys weren't real Christians. But what is a Jew supposed to think?
So this goes back to my last video. We're talking about how we are going to be persecuted as Christians. That is a fact of something that is going to continue to happen to us. We are warned about it. We should not be surprised that people want to persecute and kill us.
Man, I come in the name of Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. It don't matter how you come with me. Is you down doing what I'm talking about doing? Lawyers, and get this book open. Trained in these words to get the poor, the fatherless, and the widows up out of them penitentiaries. Are you down with that? You ain't down with that? Shut your goddamn ass up.
No,
ain't something filling my conscience, because I'm sent by Jesus to do what I'm doing. It's all, and I keep it all lawful and legal. I come in the name of Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. Anybody resisting, can goddamn my ass kiss it. I don't have you. I don't see any of you asses bearing witness for me or Jesus. I can't see none of you publishing peace. Jesus is the way to peace. Fuck what you talking about.
of the lamb who was slaughtered. Who was slaughtered? Who does the Bible say the Lamb of God is? Jesus. So Jesus, the Lamb of God, has the authority to write people's names into the book of life. Okay, so if someone's sitting there trying to say that that the Antichrist was on the cross, then who is the lamb who was slain? That's my biggest question here. If Jesus is not the one who's on the cross and Jesus is not the lamb who was slain, then you're saying that's the Antichrist, but that seems to not make any sense whatsoever given the context of the very chapter in which they've been quoting this mumbo jumbo.
The false image of the Messiah, Christ, the most common images seen in many homes and churches, is the image of Cesare Borgia, son of Pope Alexander VI, who employed Leonardo da Vinci, his son Cesare's gay lover, to paint Cesare as the Christ.
Last time you saw me, I actually came clean and told you that I wasn't the real Jesus. I also told you that I was created to make certain populations happy and comfortable. Well, I am glad to see that many of you are loyal and enjoy strong delusions and still want me as your savior. Wow, what idiots!
The slain lamb, who is Jesus, his book declares it 600 years before Muhammad, the Bible prophesied his coming. Think about that for a second, people. That means that the Bible is warning against the very thing that was to come, which was Islam. In hindsight, 2020, we can now see that it possibly fits that Islam is that beast. All those who live on earth will worship him. Who's him? That's the dragon. Everyone whose name was not written from the foundation of the world in the book of life. The whole earth was amazed and followed the beast.
The word translated opposes literally means to be against or contrary to or anti. So no wonder this man of sin is mentioned here. Now most often, he's the one associated with the Antichrist. This false prophet, this son of destruction, is a deceiver. He's a liar, a fraud. And get this, he masquerades as a true minister. Seems good. Seems right. Seems religious. But it's all deception.
And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world.
Every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, 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 is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. And is now already in the world. And is now already in the world.
Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide, and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many.
So when Muhammad went from Mecca to Medina, made his little Hajj there, it would appear as if he was fatally wounded, as if the movement of Islam was fatally wounded. But guess what? It grew in Medina into a terrible beast. All right. So we can tell that Islam is the beast, but who? Is the dragon? Well, of course, the dragon is Satan. So they worshiped the dragon because he gave authority to the beast. So who is like the beast and who is able to wage war against him? All right, so we understand that the dragon is the one that the beast says to worship. And yes, Satan is the dragon. And guess what? Satan is one. One in essence and one in personhood. So I guess if Muslims claim that they worship only one God and they worship Satan, and Satan is absolutely one. He is one, 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 one. There's only one part of him, you know, the Trinity is, you know, whatever.
And I saw three unclean spirits, like frogs, coming out of the mouth of the dragon. And we identified the dragon the other night, right? The dragon is that of the devil. He's the dragon, or as it uses it in Revelation 12 and in Daniel 7, the dragon represented pagan Rome as well. And so it says, out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. So these frogs, which the scripture says clearly are demons, come out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet, and they have a definite purpose. It says, for they are the spirits of demons, performing signs which go out to the kings of the earth and the whole world to gather them to battle the battle of the great day of God Almighty. They're drunk with the wine of her fornication, what she is teaching. This is what they're drunk with, and it's hard to get across to them what it's talking about.
said, Apo Shalabakasa, in the name of Jesus, you be made whole by the power of God.
That the Jews decided that in order to obey that text, they had to actually put the law of God on their forehead and put the law of God on their hand. Now, it was not practical to put the whole Mosaic law in a box. That would be a massive scroll. But they wanted to parade their virtue, so they made little boxes covered with black leather. They became magic charms to keep away evil, like carrying around a rabbit's foot or a lucky charm. In fact, they taught that God even wore little black boxes. I'm not exactly sure where they thought he attached them, since God is a spirit. And as time went on, the more spiritual you were, the bigger your box became. And so they broadened their boxes to parade their spirituality. Like wearing robes, backwards collars, funny cone hats, any kind of garb, any kind of superficial way to call attention to your holiness, I guess. They had no real authority. They didn't represent the truth. They had no authenticity. They appointed themselves to their position. They had no integrity. They did occasionally speak the things that are written in the Word of God, but they themselves did not even do them. They had no sympathy. They were happy to suck the life out of the people for their own personal gain. And they had no spirituality.
The Dajjal will claim to be God. And the Dajjal will have a large following. And he will mesmerize the world with his power. The Dajjal will then tell those people that I'm your Lord, believe me. And people, you know what? People will be so dumbed down that they're going to believe in him as an actual God. They'll take him as a God.
This guy's a vile person. And notice, he's not into women. Verse 37, neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women. But he's also not going to regard the desire of women, which is what most would regard in that situation, nor regard any God, for he shall magnify himself above all.
Because they insist the second beast in Revelation 13 is the United States, and the United States is not a religious system having a religious leader with a name that adds up to 666. Therefore, Adventists distort the Bible to make their assertion work. The Bible says the number 666 belongs to a man. And when the second beast in Revelation 13 appears, it will be a man, but the man will not be a pope. The second beast in Revelation 13 represents the man of sin, as he's called in the King James Version, or the man of lawlessness, as he's called in the New International Version. And he's also known throughout the Scripture as Lucifer, Satan, that ancient serpent, the devil himself. The devil will masquerade around the world as Almighty God. Billions of people will see him perform miracles, amazing miracles, signs and wonders. Billions of people will fall down and worship him, believing that he's Almighty God. The man of lawlessness is the dreaded Antichrist, Lucifer will appear to be a glorious man, but he will be a demon wearing a garment of glorious light. The greatest deception to ever occur on earth will soon take place, and Christians, by and large, do not have a clue. The world does not anticipate this coming event, and the world will not be able to escape the devil's capture of the world. Lucifer will eventually rule over the inhabitants of earth with absolute power. Paul goes on in verse 9. He says, the coming of the lawless one will be divinely glorious and awesome to behold. I've inserted those words. But in full accordance with the work of Satan, displayed how? In all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders. When the man of sin, when the man of lawlessness appears, he will appear to be divinely glorious and awesome. But he comes with all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders. He will appear to be one thing, but his actions are something else. And in every sort, verse 10, of evil that deceives those who are perishing. Now follow this carefully. They, that is the wicked, the rebellious, perish because they refused to love the truth and so be saved. Friends, you can't refuse something you haven't heard. The wicked here who are perishing are not perishing because of something they are ignorant of. No, they refused. That means they had a chance to hear the gospel. They refused to love the truth and so be saved. Verse 11, for this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion, which is the man of sin, the man of lawlessness, the Superman, so that they will believe his deceptions. They will believe the lie. They will think that he's Almighty God, and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness. So the answer to why God permits the devil to physically appear is now clear. The wicked will perish because they refuse to love the truth and be saved. And so it's because of the rebellion that God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie and be condemned. Seventh-day Adventists generally believe that Lucifer will physically appear on earth before Christ returns. But they do not have a single Bible text from Daniel or Revelation to support this belief. They don't have a single Bible text in Daniel or Revelation indicating the physical appearing of Lucifer masquerading as Almighty God and leading the world into destruction. This is very, very strange. Because Seventh-day Adventists have focused on the Pope and the Roman Catholic Church, they have totally missed the most profound point in Bible prophecy. The man, that is the second beast in Revelation 13, is not a pope. The man in Revelation 13 is a fallen angel who has been alive already for thousands of years. He was once a covering cherub in heaven. He was in Eden. He is a highly intelligent, an unbelievably sophisticated demon, extremely cunning. So let's summarize the first three biblical reasons showing that the mark of the beast has nothing to do with the Roman Catholic Church or the Pope. And this second beast in Revelation 13 is nothing more than a fallen angel attended by billions of demons. The second beast in Revelation 13 is a man, but the man is not a pope or anyone born of a woman.
The number of the beast, therefore, is given not for identification purposes, but for affirmation. When the Antichrist appears and makes his name known, the number of the beast will confirm who he is. Now, what is interesting is there's a Hebrew word, sheker, which is the word for lie or a liar, and it totals to 600. And man was created on the sixth day, so sixth is the number of man. Now, I believe, as this says, that only till that time comes, a person will not be able to totally understand what 666 means or represents.
Few people know the second kerygma will be a literal name on the literal foreheads of literal people.
And to have a cross of ash traced on their foreheads. This powerful symbol reminds us that we don't live forever. By receiving the cross of ash, we acknowledge our human frailty and our dependence upon God's healing grace. The 40 days on our Christian pilgrimage for reflecting on what really matters in our lives.
Let's go to Revelation 13, starting at verse 16. The Bible says, "He, speaking of the beast, also forced everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on his right hand or on his forehead, so that no one could buy or sell unless he had the mark, which is the name of the beast or the number of his name." The name which Lucifer will use, presently known. The name of the beast, or the number of his name. Verse 18, this calls for wisdom. If anyone has insight, let him calculate the number of the beast, for it is a man's number. His number is 666.
He's blind in the right eye. It looks like a bulging grip.
The kerygma will either be the number 666, or the kerygma will be the name of the beast, which will be tattooed on the foreheads of wicked people. Summarizing, we have two different places for the kerygma: the right hand, the forehead. And we have two different kerygmas, the number 666 and the name which the beast will use.
And with all the miracles he was allowed to perform on behalf of the first beast, he deceived all the people who belonged to this world. He ordered the people of the world to make a great statue of the first beast, who was fatally wounded and then came back to life. He deceived all the people who belonged to this world. He ordered the people of the world to make a great statue of the first beast, who was fatally wounded and then came back to life.
The false image of the Messiah, Christ, the most common images seen in many homes and churches, is the image of Cesare Borgia, son of Pope Alexander VI, who employed Leonardo da Vinci, his son Cesare's gay lover, to paint Cesare as the Christ.
Last time you saw me, I actually came clean and told you that I wasn't the real Jesus. I also told you that I was created to make certain populations happy and comfortable. Well, I am glad to see that many of you are loyal and enjoy strong delusions and still want me as your savior. Wow, what idiots!
So, as Revelation goes on, a mouth was given to him to speak, right? What did Muhammad do? He was given a mouth to speak. He boasted and blasphemes.
The world know that I am God. And from this day forth...
In what will appear to be a miracle, the idol of the Antichrist will speak, commanding the world to bow down in worship.
The power and the knowledge and the wisdom of the universe.
Satan will actually give it power. I don't know if it'll be electronically capable of speech or if it'll be supernatural. And people will hear the voice of this beast, this idol, and be tricked into worshiping it. And when they do, they will have forsaken their soul.
Let me just make it really clear to you guys, because he just made it very clear to me. So you guys take it how you want it.
And that was when Jesus told me, he said, don't feel anger for your sorrow, because your sorrow brings me love.
Know that when you talk to him, he's going to hear and he will answer back.
I want to tell you about the things that Jesus told me.
We need to hear Jesus's voice. It's like this is a how to hear Jesus's voice manual if we want to read it.
There's a testimony that I just had happen, and I wanted to share this with you guys. This is what God does for those who believe and love him. In Mark 9:23, I think it is. God, and I could be wrong, but God says everything is possible for those who believe. When he says no at first, and he's like, I have to go get some. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to still have faith here. I know we have an adversary, the devil. And so the guy comes back, and he goes, let me go see. God knocked on his heart. God did that. And then, lo and behold, glory to God, he gave me a little Tide thing to wash the clothes. So, praise the Lord and glory to God. Glory to God. Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
He began to speak blasphemies against God, to blaspheme his name and his dwelling, those who dwell in heaven. And he was permitted to wage war against the saints and to conquer them. All right. So this is nothing new for us. So Islam is spreading and the language is Arabic. The beast has authority because without the beast, the end.
Jesus does not come back with planes and guns and bombs to win the Battle of Armageddon. He comes back with the power of the Word of God and speaks the Word. I don't know what that word is. Perhaps peace. Be still. And it's over with.
And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is.
In their system, this man, this prophet Jesus, who is now in heaven, never having died, plays a key role in the end times, because he will return from heaven without dying. He will come back when Allah sends him back. Now the question to ask is, why would Allah want to send Jesus back? There's a lot of prophets to pick from. Why does he send Jesus back? Answer, so that when he shows up, he can correct all the Christians who have misunderstood who he is. Jesus is the model educator. He's the protector of his students. He will teach them and he will protect them. He will tell them what they need to know, what they need to do, and what they need to beware of and run from and avoid.
What about you? What about you? Do you love Christ? Do you embrace him as your Lord and Savior? Are you captive to a religion that you're loyal to, that is led by false teachers telling you lies and making you a prisoner of their deception? I warn you, as Jesus warned, there's only one hope of salvation, and that's in him. Reject him and you are lost forever. And the punishment is forever outside of his presence. The man made his choice, wrong choice, tragic choice. A kind of a microcosm of Judas, who encountered Jesus, saw his power, heard his words, heard his warning, and chose hell. Tragic story. Sets the tone for the rest of the gospel and the rejection to come. These children of Satan
see Jesus then as an enemy. They see him as a disturber. They see him as a blasphemer, a lawbreaker. They can't contain themselves in dealing with him. They're so full of fury at him. Why does he do this? Why does he exacerbate this conflict? Why does he elevate this? Why does he raise it to this level? Why does he say things like, you're of your father the devil, you're liars and murderers, and you desire what the devil desires? Why does he say that? Well, the answer is because he loves them. Because this is a mercy. It is a mercy to shatter false securities. It is a mercy to devastate false religion. It is a mercy to strip people locked in some form of religious deception, strip them naked of that deception. These are people with the emperor's clothes. They need to be exposed for what they are. Their false religion needs to be dealt with in a very strong, stern confrontation. The blasphemy comes in verse 48. The Jews answered, now remember, he has just said, you're of your father, the devil. That's the high point. That's the most outrageous thing that in their minds anybody could ever say of them, because they thought God was their God, as Jesus says they claim a little later in the dialogue. So he says, you're of your father, the devil. Their reaction, rather than taking the exposure and saying, whoa, help us. What are we missing? Lead us to the truth. They harden their hearts. They become harder and harder and more bitter and more bitter. And so they respond in verse 48. Here's the first blasphemy. The Jews answered and said to him, do we not say rightly that you are a Samaritan and have a demon? Apparently, they've been saying this a lot. This is their mantra. This is what they've said. As I noted a moment ago in chapter 10, in verse 20, many of them said he has a demon and is insane. This has been the standard statement about Jesus. This is what the leaders had cultivated about him. See it in Matthew 11, 18. In Mark 3, 22, it says he is possessed by Satan. A Satan-possessed, not just demon-possessed, but Satan-possessed. Matthew 12, he does what he does by the power of Beelzebub, which is another name for Satan. They were spreading the word. Here they justify it. Do we not rightly say that you are an insane, demon-possessed Samaritan? So the stakes are very high. This is not a time to invite them to some kind, in some genteel way, to embrace the blessings of salvation. This is a time to warn them, because they are in severe danger, having made the conclusions they have made. And by the way, one of their conclusions was that Jesus himself was from the devil. And he tells them, the truth is, you are the devil's children.
And I just showed you how you can do, you can theoretically come up with a concept to say that the first beast is actually Islam. Kind of fits. And that's about it, guys. Thank you so much for watching. And I was just kind of making this up a little bit, guys. It fits the description of Islam. Is it actually Islam? I don't know for sure. nope, we just throw that theology right out the window. We just want to find one particular verse that says the beast was wounded and came back to life. Because, well, who else was wounded and came back to life? Apparently it was Jesus. And apparently the Bible is saying that Jesus is the Antichrist, or the one who was on the cross was the Antichrist. Completely preposterous idea. Special kind of stupid.